about following Jesus.
I was reminded of a story I heard at the Beautiful God conference I was in Mansfield about 3 weeks ago. A story about a man who needed a job. He needed a job real bad, and he was looking, and he looked, and he looked, and finally, in the newspaper, he noticed where the local zoo was looking for someone. So he went, and he asked the zookeeper, he said, "What is it that you need to hire? What kind of work do you need?" And they said, "Well, you know, we're kind of on a strict budget, and we can't afford to buy a gorilla. So what we want you to do is put this gorilla costume on, and or this gorilla suit, and just sit in a cage. That's all you have to do." And he said, "I can't do that." And he said, "I promise you, this will be the easiest job you have ever had. You need a job, and we need a gorilla." And so he said, "All right, I'll do it. I'll do it." And so he put the suit on, and he sat in that cage, and people would come by from day to day and just look at him sitting there, you know, and he got bored. And so he thought, you know, I've got to do something, you know. So when people came by, one time he reached up and waved at one of them, and that just kind of got their attention. And then he started rolling around a little bit and doing some somersaults, and there was a little trapeze thing in there, and he would swing on that. And the more stuff he did, the more people would gather around his cage. Well, one particular day, he felt kind of spunky, I guess, and he was just doing all kinds of stuff. And the crowd kept growing and growing and growing. And the more that they clapped and the more they cheered, the higher he would swing. And he would swing, and then all of a sudden, he lost his grip. And he flew over into the lion's cage next to his. And he was scared to death. He didn't want to be eaten by the lion. And so he started screaming, "Help! Help! Help!" And the lion ran up to him and said, "Hey, buddy, be quiet. We'll both lose our jobs." I guess it was a discount too. I don't know. But you know, the man fooled the people for a little while. Even fooled you for a little while. But eventually his true identity was determined. His true identity came out. Did you know that there are 7.3 billion people in our world today? 7.3 billion people. And 2.2 billion of those people profess Christianity as their religion. The largest religion in the world. 2.2 billion people claim to be Christians in our world. But like the gorilla and like the lion, sometimes we just like to wear the suit. Sometimes we might go through the motions a little bit. But there's not that many committed followers of Christ.
Amen.
There's not that many. In fact, we really don't know. It's kind of like the children's sermon where we looked at the salt and we looked at the sugar, and we really couldn't tell which was which. God is the one who knows on the inside. Sometimes people let you know pretty much where they stand, what comes out of them, and their true identity is found out. But what does it mean to you to be a follower of Jesus? A true follower of Jesus. And I think Mark is thinking about that in our text this morning, in this ninth chapter, because what Mark does, he collects several different teachings of Jesus, several different sayings of Jesus, and he compiles them together. And I think what he is thinking is to show these disciples what it really means to be a follower of Jesus. Now, if you did your pre-reading, if you get my emails, you did your pre-reading and you read the whole of chapter 9, you know that the disciples have just come off the mountain of transfiguration and they are really puffed up with their Christianity, if you can call it that at that time, because they really feel good about themselves being followers of Jesus. And then as they're coming down, they argue who is the greatest in the kingdom. So you know right off the bat that they've got something wrong there. And so Jesus has some teachings taking place that Marco compiles. And let's look at those, because some of those are pretty tough. They come from the ninth chapter, beginning with verse 38 in our text this morning. Hear the word of the Lord. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have two feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So let's look at some of these here. These are pretty tough. The first one we pull out of the selection that Mark has, there's someone casting out demons in Jesus' name, and the disciples go over there and they stop him because he's not one of them, not part of their group. And what Jesus basically says is if another group is preaching the gospel or preaching Jesus or Christianity, leave them alone. Those who are not against us is for us. And I was reminded when I first went into ministry about 15 years ago, the bishop appointed me to a two-point charge, which meant I had one church for the early service and a different church for the late service. And it just so happens that I was appointed to a Methodist Baptist church. And so I would go to the early service was to the Methodist Baptist church, and then the late service was the regular Methodist church. And so for the early church, I would go to the Methodist Baptist church, and when you would get there, half of them would be Methodist and half of them would be Baptist. You couldn't tell by looking at them. One time we had a potluck supper, and my mom went with me, and we were sitting there, and I said, "Well, how can you tell me which one of those are Baptist and which one of them are Methodist?" And she guessed a few, and she got some right, she missed some of them, but she just couldn't tell. But I would swap out with the Baptist minister. He would come on the first and third Sunday, and then I would come on the second and fourth Sunday. And if there was a fifth Sunday, well, he got it. But you just couldn't tell the difference. And everybody showed up on that particular, every Sunday anyway, about half Methodist and half Baptist. Well, I was sharing this with one of my friends and telling him that I was the pastor of a Methodist Baptist church. He said, "You can't do that." I mean, he just kind of got angry. "You can't do that." He said, "Because we don't believe the same thing." And I said, "Well, when I go, I preach the gospel. I preach about Jesus. And when the Baptist minister goes, he does the very same thing. And it's working. And it works." Jesus said, "If they are not against us, they are for us." A follower of Jesus doesn't claim to have a monopoly on making disciples or on salvation. I know it's hard for people to believe, some people to believe. But when we get to heaven, there's going to be some Methodists, and there's going to be some Baptists, there's going to be some Church of Christ, there's going to be some Seventh-day Adventists, there's going to be some Catholics, there's going to be some Presbyterians. We're going to be there. And you know, it's okay to worship together. And it's okay to go on mission trips together and do things. The Beautiful You conference we had last night, I don't know how many different Christian denominations were there last night. But there were a lot. And it worked. We praise the Lord in that place. Followers of Jesus work together for the glory of God in Jesus Christ. Our next example, beginning in verse 42 of our text, is pretty harsh. It's harsh because Jesus wants us to get it. He wants to make sure we understand. And he's concerned that some of the so-called followers will lead others astray, specifically the little children. Because remember, some of us just wear the suit. Some of us, like the lion and the gorilla, sometimes we just put on the Christian suit. And Jesus is concerned that we might lead some of the little ones, meaning the children and new Christians, the baby Christians, we might lead them astray. So if we do that, Jesus says, if we deliberately cause another person to stumble in the faith, another one to sin, if you will, Jesus said, it would be better for you to have this huge stone, a millstone, a huge stone tied around your neck, and you'd be thrown in the sea and you just drown there. He says, that will be better than what I'm going to do to you. Basically what he says. You know, that was a gruesome punishment in Rome and in Palestine to tie that stone on your neck and throw it in the sea as a form of execution. But Jesus says that's going to be better. You just wait until I get a hold of you, is what he's saying. Sin is bad enough on its own without people who claim the Christian faith to deliberately cause another person to stumble in the faith or to sin. Jesus is much, much worse. Followers of Jesus do all in their power to lead and nurture people in the faith by their words and their actions. You know, when we baptize a baby or a new person in the faith, then the whole congregation takes those vows that we would support that person and nurture that person until they, especially the babies, until they are old enough to accept Christ for themselves. That's what Jesus is talking about. It's our responsibility. Now the next few examples beginning in verse 43 here are even more gruesome. If your hand, your foot, or your eye causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better to arrive in heaven with only one eye or one foot or one hand than to go to hell with all your body parts, basically what the text says. That's pretty gruesome. I remember several years ago, there was a news report about this woman. She took this scripture literally, and she convinced one of her friends that she had sinned with her eyes, and she had her friend to gouge her eyes out with a spoon. And it was on the news because the courts were trying to decide how they were going to try this person. And if she had actually committed a crime for doing what the person said to do. I tried to do some research on it and get an update on that, but there were so many different cases of this happening that I just couldn't find the particular one. It just blew my mind. Not all scripture is to be taken literally. Jesus is speaking in hyperbole here. He's speaking in an exaggeration because Jesus wants to have the shock event to us. Jesus is serious about those things that cause us to fall into sin. And Jesus desperately wants us to separate ourselves from those things or those people. Sometimes it's people that we need to separate ourselves from in the faith. Another example that I like to share, it's been several years ago, I've read in the Texas Co-op and Power magazine. If you own that, you get that magazine. But there was a story in there about a man named Aaron Ralston many years ago, maybe 10, maybe 12 years ago, something like that. And Aaron Ralston was a backpacker and a rock climber, and he was in Utah, Canyonlands National Park in Utah, and he was climbing a huge boulder, and the boulder, the 1,000-pound boulder, shifted and pinned his arm against the canyon wall. And for 2 days, he waited there without food or water for someone to come along, but this was a remote area and a deserted area, and no one ever came. He knew that he had to do something. He had two choices. He could die in that lonely place, or he could amputate his own arm. And so Aaron Ralston took out his pocket knife, and he cut off his right arm, put a makeshift tourniquet on, rappelled 75 feet down to the canyon floor, and within hours he was on a helicopter on his way to the hospital. He saved his life. Let me ask you, could you do that? Could you do it if it meant saving your life? You know, through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, a follower of Jesus recognizes the area of their lives that are not healthy, that are not compatible with Christian teaching, and they separate themselves from those things. They separate themselves from those people. We recognize that. Let's look at verse 49. We get to the salt issue here in verse 49. You know, in first century, salt was a precious commodity. It was used for many different things. One was to as a preservative for the meat, because there was no refrigeration. And there was a type of salt around the Dead Sea that was, it wasn't pure. It wouldn't hold its saltiness. And salt merchants who were not very honest would go in there and gather that up because it looked the same, much like the salt and sugar I shared with the children this morning. It looked the same, and so they would just mix it together, and that way they could sell more salt. But they were cheating the people because it wouldn't hold its saltiness. So can you imagine gathering your meat for the winter, and then salting it, and then going in there against them, and find out that all your meat has ruined. So it is with the Christian life. The follower of Jesus is seasoned and preserved with the real thing, with Jesus Christ. And there are no salt substitutes. There are no substitutes for being seasoned with Jesus Christ. The true follower of Jesus can't put on the Christian suit one day a week and go through the motions when it's convenient. Following Jesus is a way of life. It's a way of life. A 24/7 commitment. So I ask you again, what does it mean for you to be a follower of Jesus? What does it mean for you to be a follower of Jesus? Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for Mark's gospel and the way he compiles Jesus' teaching.